Support for Character Crusade comes from audiobooks.com. Audiobooks make it possible to enjoy a story, learn something new, or find inspiration anytime, anywhere. And with more than 60,000 titles available, audiobooks.com makes it easy and convenient. Simply set up your account and start downloading your favorite books to your mobile device. Right now, you can start with a free 30-day trial and select the book of your choice to get started. Go to book.charactercrusade.com and start listening today.
Virtually without beverage.
We are. You're dewed up. I'm liquefied here with dangerous H2O.
Yes.
And Joe is going to be parched.
I'm going solo.
Beverageless.
Beverageless.
The empty red solo cup is so sad.
Well, welcome, dear listeners, to episode 10 tonight. We're talking about immersion, and we're going to talk about lore. We've got an interview later on this evening with Cory Merchant, who is famous for his Elder Lore podcast on iTunes.
And probably not related to Natalie Merchant, I would expect.
You never know.
Okay, just checking.
You never know. Let's not rule it out.
All right. Well, we're good to ask him.
Yes.
That's a question. That's what interviews are for, right?
Yes, which a question I'm sure he'll appreciate.
Don't let me ask that question, okay?
I will not.
Riveting.
Can you hang that guy up? That would be great.
Yeah, I will throw my shoe at you across the room.
Thanks, yes.
But first, before we do that, we have a couple of announcements. We're going to keep it brief tonight, but we do have some shout-outs, right, Matt?
We really do. We have three. Thank you to everybody on iTunes. Escargot 1887, I'm sure we've got French references here going on, but 5 stars and the humongous write-up of Simply Sensational.
Yes.
Don't mince words.
Some people could tweet, this is sort of like a chirp.
There you go. That's all right.
This is great. Simply Sensational. And thank you,
I
Escargot 1887.
Thank you.
The next one is, ever need tips for role-playing, enhancing your game? These are the guys you want. Well, maybe those guys are, not me. By headshot like a Bosmer is what it says.
Oh, headshot nice. Like a Bosmer. I love that.
That's a good one.
That's a good one, yeah.
Yeah, and how can you get more out of your game? Character involvement. We ought to use involvement. That's a good one. Hmm. These guys are the best at crafting roleplay characters. Tips on how to flesh out your characters. Much more. Roleplay, mods, gameplay, and other fun events. Events.
Ooh, yes.
That makes it sound so epic.
Well, can't that is awesome.
Well, and thank you, Headshot Like a Bosmer.
Love that.
And then the last one that we have for this episode anyway, which is still episode 10, by the way, awesome resource by Packet Loss TV, probably my favorite gamer tag so far. Been following Fleet for a very long time, and I'm glad to see that Stu, creator of Fleet and Crew, are continuing to entertain the community. Love the information in these shows. Makes me think as I play my version of Skyrim, really adds to my enjoyment of the role-playing experience. You've awesome. Succeeded. Both. Cool.
Yay.
You won over it. Packet Loss TV.
Yeah.
That was fantastic.
I'm fairly certain we read one of his questions at some point, didn't we?
Sounds familiar.
Doesn't sound familiar, mm-hmm. but...
I would not discourage anybody from submitting more questions. Yeah. Questions are good.
Yeah, there's no limit.
Absolutely.
Only one per user per year, no.
Well, you know, the plan is that next episode is the episode where we're going to hit a whole bunch of questions.
Stu, right? I'm fairly sure that we closed the books on people being able to submit more questions. We've got a lot of questions, I think.
Yes, we have a lot of questions on Aranus Arcana. The next episode is going to be dedicated to answering as many of those questions as I can get through. So,
yeah. I'm sure everyone is looking forward to it, as am I.
Well, it'll be good to, you know, yeah. get some of those off the books. There have been people who've had questions out for, you know, a couple months now. So
we'll address those finally.
And the bloody clawing at the glass out here might stop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we don't need any more of that.
No. Getting first, complaints.
First, we thought that they were vampires or zombies. Something else.
Well, I think I'm pretty excited about tonight. But before we... get into character craft. We're going to go around character craft, do a brief review of where we're at with characters since we didn't get to cover it last week with our interview with Dave. Before we do that, one quick announcement. I did make an announcement earlier. I guess it was late last week, actually, now that I think about it, of the return of the Dark Messenger location-based playthrough on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
We're bringing that back, and I'm pretty excited about it. You may have also seen that this week there was a release of the first episode of Skyrim Anthology, and there is a 45-minute video in there you can check out. That video was available exclusively to the Patreon network. That's kind of what we're doing with the anthology videos. The Patreon network gets them first for a couple of weeks, and then they get released into the wild. So that was the first anthology episode. I would expect to see our first episode of Dark Messenger later this week. That will be released onto YouTube in general, not the Patreon network exclusively. But so we'll see that return of the location-based playthrough featuring our Redguard Archer Assassin Centrosi. So looking forward to that.
Sweet.
Cool. Yeah. So let's get into some serious character craft. Stick around. Okay, it's another character craft segment. It's been a couple episodes now since we did one. We're going to go around the whole group, right, guys?
All the way around the horn.
Yep,
you got it.
All right. Let's start with you, Joe. What's been going on? I know you've got more than one character going, so give us an update on whichever one's been floating your boat the most recently.
Okay. Well, yeah, I've got Hinto and Ienarath, and I've actually been kind of tweaking around with the mod organizer as of late, so I haven't had as much play time with either of them really as I'd like to, but just trying to get that thing settled down and getting Hinto up. So I've kind of got him going up to speed, so maybe I'll just hit them both real lightly.
Sure.
So we'll start with Hinto, and his deal is right now he is continuing his quest to find the Jürgen Windcaller, or the horn of Jürgen Windcaller. If he finds Jürgen, that's even better.
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
That would be. But we'll settle for the horn. So
yeah.
He is on his way to, what's her name? Delphine.
Okay. Now, did you finish the companion's quest too? Are you done with that?
Yes, actually, yes. Oh,
okay,
yes.
Cool.
So I am now the Harbinger.
Very nice.
Of the companion's quest line, which feeds to him quite well, because now he feels like he's got a pretty good solid base of people to choose from when he really kind of starts doing his own thing on more of a, you know, scale, a bigger scale with others.
Right. Yeah, it gives you access to a whole bunch of trainers too, which, I mean, yeah, that's yeah, that one helps. Of the big advantages for of sure. doing the companions quest line is all the trainers.
So. Mm-hmm. So, yep, he finished that up, and now he is, I can't remember, is she in River, not Riverwood, she's not in Riverwood, is she?
Yeah, she is.
Is Del, okay.
Delphine, yeah, she's at the Sleeping Giant
okay.
in Riverwood.
For some reason, I just mm-hmm. losing it in my
You
head.
Are like a fount of knowledge.
Yeah, I am, pretty much, yes.
I don't know where anything is.
A steaming pile of knowledge.
don't step in the knowledge.
Warm, right. steaming pile of knowledge.
Oh, excellent. Yes.
Mm.
Okay.
All right. So
one noise too many.
Yeah. So that's, yeah, you should talk.
We always take it too far, don't we? We always take it just one notch too
no
far.
No chaps this week.
No chaps. Okay. So, okay. So he is on his way down there and, that's kind of where he's at the moment. So he's doing pretty well.
Okay.
And, I changed out some of his weapons and his armor a little bit. I was able to get his smithing up to where I could start putting the armor together that I want, which is unpronounceable. Einherjar, Ienarath.
I think it's the Einherjar.
Yes, thank you.
Einherjar.
There's two versions, light and heavy, and he's going light, so.
Okay. Cool.
And then I upgraded one of his axes to a Skyforge steel.
Mm.
Very nice.
Which, as you know, there's no finer.
There is no finer. Which I, you know, this here's the thing that really annoys me. I went to talk to Yorlin Greymane. He's like claims to be the greatest, you know, Skyforge steel is the best ever. And every time I go to talk to him, he has no steel to sell. He
what
never
a,
has
no,
steel in inventory.
What a loser.
No, that's very true. That's very true.
It makes me angry.
Yeah,
I can't leave it with
now
him.
That you mention that, I've had to go and put this, get the ingots and create my own at a forge.
Yeah.
Well, he didn't realize it was sort of a bring your own sort of scenario.
BYOS.
Bring your own steel. Well, you know.
It's craft day.
Is that like
we'll be
home...
firing them on the weekend.
It's like at Home Depot, you know, where you can go and get a little class on how to make a birdhouse.
Bring the kids.
Yeah.
Make your own Skyforge
cool.
steel.
Yeah. So. Yorlin Greymane seminars. That would
there
be
you
amazing.
Go.
Available on Udemy and what other training sites have we got? Linda.
I'm making a mod.
There you go.
There you go.
Actually, that would be great. You can. Yeah. That'll be maybe you can put it that in the treasure chest.
Yorlin Greymane
seminars.
Today we're building birdhouses.
You sound a little bit like Gru. That's fabulous. That would be great, though.
Ah.
Oh, funny. Okay, so that's kind of really all I've got for Hinto. And okay. So Ienarath, my Dunmer, she is been out and about trying to make some cash. To be quite honest, she needs coin.
Okay.
Because I'm using the Tundra defense that you went over through your video very nicely. And I think Bro Duel's done a nice job with it as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I am starting to put that together down in Blackreach.
That's what I think is so cool. You're building a fortress in Blackreach.
I am building a Tundra outpost in Blackreach, which just is hilarious with some of the dialogue. You know, oh, I've heard your outpost and I'm really interested in setting up. I'm like, no, you're not.
How could you possibly have heard of my outpost, first
no,
of all?
Seriously, you really don't want to be there.
No,
but welcome.
The Whiterun guards are sending up flags and messages. You have to go check it out.
So I've been putting together potions, trying to go up to the surface and sell them off to whoever has enough gold to buy them all.
Yeah,
I've been depleting most of the merchants with their gold coin.
Yeah,
just because you know you put together a couple hundred, you know, septim gold potion, and it doesn't take much for those to run them empty.
It takes to really make significant money, unless you're willing to just dive into the speech tree big time.
Right.
It just takes forever because of the limited gold that the merchants have.
Oh.
You sell them two potions and they're depleted and then you're off again, you know, and it's...
Right. So I've gone to both Dawnstar and mostly White Run lately. She was trying to avoid White Run for a while because of Felglobe Cave or Felglobe Keep being close by, which is the murder of necromancers.
That yeah, that was her clan.
Sent her out to, you know, die in Aflan. So
yeah.
Some resentment there.
So she's avoided them carefully, making careful trips to Whiterun. And part of that because she has to when she heard about the blacksmith and leaving his gear for her, which is part of Tundra.
So. Yeah, that's kind of a cool feature. You know, you get to a certain level and you get a note. You just check the
well and you get all these little notes and you can determine what it is that you want to actually build. Mm-hmm. So I purchased some walls and I put up a nice kind of a courtyard around Sindarian's field lab with, I chose Dwemer walls.
Makes sense.
So she, found some artisans that could craft stone walls.
Well, yeah, and probably repurposing stuff that's what's already around. Cut down there too.
Right. So. Yeah, and actually a note came up for a mine. So you can build a mine. I got the mine note. So, and it was actually pretty funny that in the note they had mentioned that there was some Dwemer artifacts or something.
Oh, really?
I'm like, really?
Huh. See, now that would be interesting. What if you build the mine and then there's some way in the mine to like keep going deeper into more Dwemer ruins below that? You're kind of nesting mods here.
Yeah, well, I very well could actually with the Live Anywhere mod.
Yeah.
I could easily do that.
So you're using Live Anywhere along with Tundra Defense.
Yeah, and the two far are meshing quite nicely.
I can imagine.
So I've got a nice little courtyard with a stone wall around Sindarian's lab, and then I built a larger wooden wall structure around kind of that upper area.
Okay.
That like little hilltop where the field house is. So that's working. I finally got some gates and enough coin to buy the everything to wall it in.
Yeah.
So now I'm empty again. So now I got to, before
go
I can
make
start,
more money.
Before I can start building other stuff.
Like quality DIY time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, it's going pretty well.
Cool. I think it's cool that you kind of get a little mix of both characters in since our last update. Although it has been a while, so that's plenty of time.
Yeah, it has. So I'm feeling pretty good where my system is sitting and where all the mods are coming up and as far as running. So, I think I can either trade off on either one of them or just take one and run.
Yeah, so. Sounds good. Make one the follower of the other and alternate back and forth.
There you go.
Yeah. How about you, Matt? What's going on?
Well, I was running into some personal play issues with Einar Stigander. I had made one change in the game that I felt really kind of lousy about. He was all over the place because I had given him as much gold as he wanted.
Oh.
And some part of me said, you know, I wanted to sort of find my way around the game, right? But after the first conversations we had about character creation, I was feeling like I needed to play through, and I said, no. Mm. Everybody's got multiple characters, and I thought I would try on something else for size. And so as I was mentioning to Joe, I created a new character, Khajiit.
No, so you went elsewhere.
I went elsewhere. And so I had, after your comments earlier about every place where you go, no matter what level you're at, they always welcome you back as Whelp. So my Khajiit's name is Whelp.
Oh, I like that.
Perfect. Because then sort of like cheers, right? Every time you come in,
Whelp.
Yay, so, it's the Whelp.
Perfect.
So I've gone through, again, the beginning of the game and still back to level one, which I have really nothing much to say about, except when you follow some of the initial gameplay that I, for some stupid reason, completely skipped last time around. I had not run into any of the merchants. I had not run into any of the trainers. I had not run into half of the people that I think I probably should have. And so, you know, now I've made my way up to Dragon's Reach, spent quite a bit of time just stopping to meet with everybody, right? And reading all the books and going back in to read every single book in the in Dragon's Reach. You go back and you meet the alchemist or whoever it is, and I'm like, I don't know Farengar. Which any of these books are going to be valuable, so I'm going to read all of them.
That's awesome. I've been trying to do that a little bit myself. I haven't powered through a lot of them in one setting, but I've tried to do kind of that same thing. Never sit down if it's early in the morning, and I'll
just didn't know what I would get out of it, right?
And read through it.
So it's kind of fun, and I was realizing that I had spent so much time trying to race into the action in the beginning with Ienarath, who's, I mean, this huge guy. I'm still not running any mods in any of the games. It's just that, you know, I sort of went after it with reckless abandon, like any other sort of first-person shooter, instead of, you know, actually taking on the game as the character. So still trying to figure my way through just the mechanics of now I'm a different character. It's nice that they refer to you differently. It's kind of fun. The armor and everything that I've picked up, it is all because of work, learning how to craft things and making daggers and all that stuff. I'm going through all of it this time rather than sort of skipping past the bits that I thought were maybe not worth my time the first time through. And it really invests you more in the game, right? So you spend a little bit more time, but now I'm wearing all stuff that I found or bought and made, that's cooler that way.
Very good.
That's cool. That's always one of my favorite things about starting a new character, is just kind of, you know, following wherever the game leads and then seeing what interesting items you pick up along the way that you can, you know, keep swapping out for better gear over the first, say, 10 levels or so. And then just to kind of see where you end up, you know.
And I found I'm not nearly as hampered by the desire to pick up and hoard everything. And because now I know where you can, you know, I didn't kill the people.
That's a good start.
You can't kill the traitors. But I had done that in the last one, and I didn't run into all of the other Khajiit outside of Whiterun, where the first place I really tried to sell something or buy something. And I didn't get that in the last time through because I was in such a hurry to get into the city that I found some horrible back way that spent like 15 minutes trying to jump through hoops. It was ridiculous. So it's amazing what happens when you just walk in the front door. you know, and you stop there and you make yourself some daggers and step inside and see all the cool weapons that you can't afford yet.
Well, because I actually have never played a Khajiit or an Argonian. I'm kind of curious when... How do people react or how do the NPCs refer to you? So, for example, with the Dunmer, a lot of times they'll say, you know, what do you need, little elf?
And they'll
curious, what did they do for the other races?
They've referred to me as the cat or something like that.
Oh, okay.
The guards in Whiterun are getting very confused because I've just been standing still for quite some time now. but I wanted to find out some of the interaction, right? You can go through all those. Right. Oh, well, I'm sure that somebody stole your sweet roll. But,
dear listeners, in case you hadn't gathered by now, when we're sitting here talking during this podcast, Matt is actually got the game up, and he's like messing around with his character while we're talking.
Partly because you remember everything, like it's tattooed on your brain. I have to remember everything. You know, it's night, and then
Yeah. Well, I think that's cool. I like that because every once in a while it'll go quiet. You know, is it when I'm doing post-production, there'll be this quiet point. I'm like, what were we doing then? Oh, yeah, we were looking at Matt's computer, you know.
But the detail that you can get, I would really love to see the game on super, ultra, mega high settings. Mine's right in middle of the road right now. But it's completely playable, and it's fast. And again, with no mods, I haven't decided to do anything, and I haven't changed the character in any way this time. At least a little bit of the experience from, you know, the first 30, 40 hours of playing Ienarath should be really helpful in figuring out where I need to go. And now I've got some reference points When people mention artifacts and locations, now I sort of know where they are. Right.
Right.
Like
right.
some distant relative you remember meeting a few years ago.
Well, let me ask you this. Mm-hmm. Given the amount of time that you've played so far, have you ever gone anywhere in Skyrim yet where there was snow?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So
yeah,
so
way up to the what felt like the top of the world.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you went up a mountain.
And,
yeah. Up, you went up the throat of the world.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Up by
okay.
The,
but I don't know how I got there, right? Because I was riding a horse,
yeah,
slaying a dragon on some side, and I just kept going up and up and up uh-huh. and up. And I didn't. There's a dragon up there. Then there's a frost troll, and
yep.
yeah, yeah, it was very unpleasant.
Yeah.
I died many times.
It's a rough journey.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds to me though you're adventuring in a fairly small circle.
Yes.
In the
middle
of
the map.
World is
yeah.
mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, if you wander north, you just kind of keep walking north. You hit the snow because you went to the higher altitudes.
Yeah,
it's interesting. It would be interesting to see a little heat map or something of the places you've been so far. Because I've discovered with certain characters that, I've gotten to, 30, level 30, level 40, and realized that I'd never gone anywhere where the weather was cold yet. Like, 'cause there's so much to do in that space I was in, you know? That's kind of interesting.
Well, I'm not leveling up very fast, that's for sure. Mm-hmm. But, again, I'm trying to figure out what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Interacting with a lot more people, picking up tons of stuff now. I have inadvertently cast aside what I'm sure were very valuable things in my haste for trying to move on to the next thing.
Have you come up with kind of a backstory for
no,
the character
I'm working
yet?
On that. Okay. I'm hoping to have that for the next time.
I think kind of once that all comes together and you have a real good feel for the character, leveling probably won't be much of an issue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Things will pop pretty quick.
And I think with Ienarath, there was no story behind it because I didn't understand anything about it, right? I sort of teleported into the mm-hmm. world and didn't know anything really about what was going on other than the fact that those jerks in the beginning thought that I was part of the thievery.
you took her ball.
The first time through, right, I didn't even get any weapons going through while you're trying to kill the dragon, right? So I don't know how I managed to survive. But no bow, no anything. I ended up somewhere with a wood axe.
That is crazy. Yeah. I just don't even know how it's possible.
I'm not saying I'm smart.
Well, I can't wait until you get to the point where you've played this character long enough that you start talking with a Khajiit accent.
Oh, there you go.
That is
I have
great.
To listen to more Khajiit.
Khajiit is actually one of my daughter's favorite characters.
Hmm? Oh, yeah.
That's what she's playing right now.
Yeah, so. A lot of people really are partial to playing Khajiit. I would recommend if you were going to install a mod, go and get the Inigo mod. He's a Khajiit follower, and he's really, really well voiced. And you can pick him up in Riften.
Okay.
And if you travel around with him for a while, you'll start to pick up on how they talk. It's really interesting. And he makes some great conversation too. He's a wonderful mod or wonderful follower add-on for the game.
Well, maybe next time we'll have more.
Yeah. Cool.
All right.
Very good.
So that's all I've got for this time.
Awesome.
All right. Well, I guess we'll get into mine next. So for my character, a couple of different things. I've been continuing to work on Robbard, obviously. We touched on him a little bit several weeks ago, but it was brief. At that time, I was still kind of working on the story. You remember, I did finally get all of my mods working the way that I wanted to, which is awesome. And really kind of solidified the backstory and what I've what I finally decided to do was kind of go that route of, saying that he's the son of Ravencrone,
mm-hmm.
but he's an illegitimate some.
Right. Yep.
So I think before when we had talked last, I was kind of on the fence about whether I wanted to do that or not. But I just went ahead and made him full-on bastard in more ways than one. So, I kind of did that, got started. I think at this point I'm up around probably level 22 with him. A lot of kicking around in Falkreath and stuff like that. I think what's been really interesting about him is in order to support what I'm trying to come up with in terms of his personality, I started putting some Robbard quotes out on Google+. So if you subscribe to Couch Warrior TV and Character Crusade Google+, you're going to see a bunch of Robbard quotes out there. And my objective was to try to use the quotes to truly capture the essence of his personality. And I thought, you know, this would be a great exercise for me to engage in order to kind of capture how I wanted to play him. But then it would also be sort of fun to share with other people as kind of a snapshot of his profile. And I've got some examples here. So, and what I do is I couple these with some nice screenshots. So I have a screenshot of him, and he's sitting on the railing of the porch in front of Dead Man's Drink in Falkreath. And if you've ever been to Falkreath, like during the day, the woman, the barmaid who works there, she'll come out and she'll stand right there.
Yeah, she'll lean on the rail.
Rail, and she'll look out on Main Street to see what's going on. And so he's sitting up on the railing, smoking a cigarette, okay?
Perfect.
And she's looking at him, and it goes like this. Her name is Nari, and Robbard says, "Look, Nancy, it was fun and all, but this isn't effing true love." And then she says, "It's Nari. My name is Nari, you pig. Do you treat everyone like they're nothing?" And he responds by saying, "Whatever, Nancy. We all enter relationships as something and leave as nothing. I stopped being something a long time ago."
Wow. Yeah, he is a bastard.
Yeah. This was the thing. I thought, okay, I really need to, I've always wanted to play him as an irreverent prick. So
I think that captures it.
How do we capture that?
You might have completely done it in that one.
Yeah. And there's another one of him standing in kind of an alleyway with his cigarette and a smug look on his face. And it just says, pray to whichever the eight make you feel suitably righteous. I'm sure you get exactly what you effing deserve.
Nice. Is there a cancer mod?
I don't know. I think they call that Elderwind.
Oh.
It's not Robbard, mm-hmm. You witless.
Yeah. So then the next one is, why the hell would you buy your crank from Rasad? My horse craps better, Skooma. Although he doesn't use the word crap. I used a stronger term there. But so, you know, it was kind of an exercise in just figuring out the sort of person that he was. And what I love about it is when I'm getting to the point where, okay, I'm ready to sit down and spend a couple hours playing Robbard, I have to get in his head, right? And I'll read a couple of these quotes and I'll be like, yeah, that's the jerk he is, and that's how I'm going to play him. And it's super fun, man. I finally got him up to Riften and got him into the Thieves Guild and stuff.
Oh,
and
cool.
So he's started that off now. The last couple weeks, I've whiled away a lot of time just trying to reset Centrosi now and get ready to roll out Dark Messenger again.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've been investing a lot of time in just, you know, tweaking mods. When you're doing a Let's Play and when you're playing a character for other people's entertainment, you have to spend an inordinate amount of time making sure that you have a good baseline and a smooth game.
Mm-hmm.
So I've had to run you know, a lot of different tests and mods, and I'm trying to make sure I'm running good ENBs and a clean game. And so the last couple of weeks have been really mostly about investing in all of that setup time. So I haven't had a chance to play Robbard in a couple of weeks, but
You're channeling him.
I'm really looking forward to getting back to him. Yeah, he's so much fun. And I'm planning on putting some more Robbard quotes out there soon. So
good character.
Yeah, that's my character craft the last few weeks. All right.
Not bad.
Yep. So next, we are going to go into our play theory segment, and we're going to have an interview with Mr. Cory Merchant. So stick around. Welcome, listeners, to our Play Theory segment. We are very happy to have with us via Skype, Mr. Cory Merchant. Welcome, Cory.
Good to be here.
Good. For those of you who don't know, which is probably just one or two of you, Cory has a podcast called Elder Lore Podcast. And that podcast is just filled with all kinds of great information on Elder Scrolls lore that kind of spans all the games. Isn't that right, Cory?
Yeah, certainly. And many stuff that's not included in the games, really.
Yeah, like I think one of the things that we definitely wanted to hit on is try to find out a little bit more about kind of how you piece those episodes together. In other words, where you did some of your research and what resources you used, because I think a lot of the people who listen to our podcast are looking for ways that they can sort of enrich their gaming experience. And sometimes that has to do with background stories and lore and all those kinds of things. And sure. I think there's more material out there than a lot of people realize.
Oh, yes.
Have you read any of the Elder Scrolls books, the novels and things like that?
So I have read, the Infernal City and the book that came, Lord of Souls.
Okay.
The Gregory Keyes' two kind of back-to-back books. But I never talked about those on the podcast because I didn't want to dissuade people from going and reading them on their own.
Right.
That was kind of one of the things that a lot of people asked for a lot. And to some extent, I don't really have much of a problem retreading events of previous games because, you know, everybody kind of has their own experience anyway. But I did kind of want to leave the books to be one of those things that people really should go out and read. When I was first starting my podcast, those many years ago, I found this was before I think they were officially collected in any way. But somebody, you know, on a message board somewhere, had compiled all of the in-game books into an e-reader format. And I was, I had just graduated. So I was kind of graduated college. So I was I'm a teacher. So I was substitute teaching at the time. And I had a lot of spare time and I had this wonderful resource, all these ebook versions of all these books that appeared in the game. And so, that was kind of all at the beginning of when I had first, when I first started making the recordings. And those, as I've often said on the podcast, those are really the place to go if you're hungry for more information. There's so much in there that you could just bypass when you're playing the game and still have a wonderfully enjoyable experience. But if you are willing to kind of dig a little deeper And I think every character I've ever played in any of the games has had some sort of book collection. And of course, those are all available on the unofficial Elder Scrolls pages, which is a wonderful resource, UESP.net. I don't know if you guys use it or if your listeners do. UESP is great. And of course, the Imperial Library is fantastic. It's a fantastic resource for not only the in-game books, but also kind of fan-made apocrypha, which I never really spent too much time covering in the podcast, but always kind of let it inform my own opinions, because there's some really intensely interesting things out there that fans create, not only in terms of the mods and everything like that, but just, you know, straight up kind of written fan-made lore that really goes above and beyond what you know, the kind of casual RPG experience. And some of that is available too on the Elder Scrolls lore subreddit, you know, which is reddit.com/r/TESLORE. That's really where I got my start on the subreddit. When I first started making episodes, I posted them there first and was amazed at the outpouring of support for them. And really, I probably wouldn't have continued making them if I didn't have that kind of people kind of clamoring me to keep recording them. So, I mean, all of the information is out there. You know, you just have to be kind of willing to go find it. I'm endlessly amazed at how many people I've been able to reach out and touch, and how many people have kind of had a, in one way or another, just an increased immersion or increased enjoyment of the games because of what I've done. And, you know, I have to say that, you know, I wouldn't have made anything if all of these other people hadn't done all this other stuff too. So those are the resources that I've always used. The UESP, the Imperial Library is great, and so on and so forth.
Okay. Unintentional collaboration.
Right.
But, yeah.
I, for one, being a little bit latecomer, having just finished up your podcast maybe 3 weeks ago or so, I'm going to be cycling back to it because there is so much information.
Yes.
And I'm really glad that, you know, people were clamoring for it and that you did continue.
Yeah. I also like how you, there's a particular episode. Well, there's a couple of them, I think, where this happens. But one in particular I think of is your episode on getting metaphysical, I love how you pull in some of the things, some of the discussions you were seeing on the forums, you know, and actually cite individuals who are putting interesting ideas out there or theories, you know, whether it was having to do with the, you know, some of that really high level stuff, the stuff that you did about Kim and all that, where it was, you know, getting sort of way beyond what you read about in the books and game and to some of the really esoteric stuff, I thought was kind of interesting. So
I often people, and I haven't, you know, actively been making new episodes in a while, but I still have people reaching out to me regularly.
Very cool.
And a common refrain is that people seem to, I'm going to generalize a little bit, but people seem to enjoy those episodes more than the other ones. Not that they don't enjoy the other ones,
right,
but maybe they don't have such a readily available outlet to get that kind of really out there esoteric information. Mm-hmm. And you know, I'm just me. I'm not under the employ of Bethesda Game Studios, so I can talk about that stuff.
Right.
But yeah, that was really, I mean, as many people say, Morrowind for me was my first Elder Scrolls experience. And so that game obviously had a very large impact on me as a gamer, but also me on kind of how I consumed, you know, I'll say artwork. I'll go out there and I'll say artwork. And then to find out, you know, even years later, after having played that game and having so much enjoyment in it, that there was this whole aspect about Vivek, about Kim, and about, you know, all of these other kind of buzzwords that I could throw out there. Mm-hmm. that, and again, all this information is right there in the 36 lessons if you sat down and collected them and read them.
Oh, how it's all right there.
Yeah, and, you know, and you know, my, you know, back when I was in high school playing Morrowind, I never sat down and took those books off the shelves and read them in game. But it's all there, and echoes of it, of course, ripples of it that kind of pass through Oblivion, and on into Skyrim. So it's all of these little things. It's the little bits about the lore, and it's also the kind of little bits about it that are, for me at least, the mysterious parts of it. That's what make it interesting.
Yeah, I think we all like look for things in the lore, like little seams we can exploit to tell some backstory that we want to tell. I think one of the things that's really cool about this game is because the lore is so rich, you know, it's one of the few games where you can have entire online communities that are just dedicated to doing nothing but just discussing the lore.
Right.
You know, a lot of games, if you find an online community, it's about, you know, cheats and tutorials and stuff like that. Yeah. But, you know, if you look like the Temple Zero Society, I mean, I think it's monkeytruth.net or whatever. It's
right.
But that whole thing, that's just a whole bunch of people who just discuss lore, which I think is kind of amazing. So,
yeah. And it's always interesting to me the kind of, devoted, fanatical cult following that Michael Kirkbride has kind of accumulated over time. Of course, this being the individual that wrote the 36 lessons, that we can ascribe most of the more esoteric parts, even in Oblivion. You know, he wrote a lot of the stuff for the Knights of the Nine expansion, which, if you take a step back and look at it, is pretty esoteric. You know, all of this stuff with Pelin of Whitestrake and all of this really kind of obscure kind of nonsense, I'll call it. But, you know, it's like Rocky Horror Picture Show or something. You know, there's like this really, not really small, but really fanatical following, for, especially since, you know, the you know, Coda has been released and, you know, he not even kind of like being a part of the company or the game's development anymore, has still managed to kind of turn everything on its head. It's really, I can't think of any other fictional universe that anybody can say that about. Like, people still talk about Middle Earth, obviously. I love Middle Earth. And Middle Earth has its own mysteries. But people don't, I don't think they sit and dissect it as much as modern day fans of the Elder Scrolls universe do. I'm not sure why. Maybe it's the difference between, you know, consuming a novel and consuming a video game and the hours of enjoyment you get out of it. I'm not really sure.
Could be the medium.
Right. But it's definitely true. People sit there and really, I mean, I did for years when I was kind of making this podcast, it kind of like became my life. And, because it's really easy to lose yourself in it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's what makes the difference, right? You know, in the case of Middle Earth, when I think of that, we're losing ourselves in someone else's creation, right? And here's our opportunity to make a creation of our own, which means it's even that much more meaningful. And we're even that much more inspired to dig into all of those books and find those pieces that we want to use to tell our own story, which I think gets at that really immersive quality that you were talking about.
I think
about.
Lends just as well is when you unexpectedly come across a piece of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that triggers the light bulbs in your, you know, in your head. You're like, I could use this, you know, to help drive your character,
yeah,
you know, one way or another, or it pulls something together you didn't expect.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yep.
Absolutely.
And you're right too. I mean, having access to that information on a Kindle, it wasn't long after Skyrim came out that I was sitting around thinking, you know, I want to, kind of create my own backstory. Sure would be nice if I had those in-game books in some format that I could just kind of read through them and look for nuggets of things that would be interesting. Yeah. And I remember saying, I wonder if anybody's put it on ebook or whatever. And, you know, it, 2 seconds to Google it, bang, there it was. And I'm like, yep. Oh my God, there it is. and so, you know, I was glued to my Kindle for like a month and I read them all on the Kindle, you know? And so that made a huge difference, being able to read that. I love that. That's cool. So I guess one of the things that we wanted to talk about was immersion, obviously. You have really kind of poured a lot of effort into, you know, pulling things that you thought would be of interest to the community out of the lore and sort of focusing on those different things. I know for me, background story and having a character that's kind of, you know, steeped in some of that lore, you know, they're invested in that lore in some way, whether it's through worship of a god or family history or whatever it is important to me. For my purposes, I recently went through your podcasts and tried to pull out the ones that I thought would have something to do with Lorcan, because over the current playthrough, I'm focusing on Lorcan as a god of interest. And it was really valuable to me to, like, you know, driving down the road, listen to the podcasts on these things, and the ideas started coming, right?
Right.
For you, when you've been playing through games like Oblivion and Skyrim and Morrowind and stuff, I mean, I guess I'm always interested to know what immersion means to different folks. I know for us as role players, it's very specifically about our character and the narrative going on in our head, but I'm interested to hear kind of what your experience has been.
So in the past, my approach has usually been, interestingly enough, to not so much focus at what kind of, like, when I'm consuming information about the lore or about Tamriel's history or whatever, is to not really focus on the character that I'm playing, but rather to just kind of to know as much as I can at all times. And then when I'm playing, I can, on the fly, I can kind of make you know, gut decisions about, well, okay, you know, yes, I know that, you know, so-and-so, I don't know, let's say, okay, let's say I know that, you know, Tiber Septim was responsible for the first Thalmor, you know, being dissolved. And that's why they disallow the worship of Talos at the beginning of the game Skyrim. But the character that I'm playing right now is going to be ignorant of that because he's been working on a farm his whole life. So the way that I've always kind of played games that I'm willing to get immersed in is to really kind of eat, drink, and sleep it. You know, if I can, I mean, I'm thinking about it when I'm in the shower, I'm thinking about it when I'm getting ready to go to bed, I'm thinking about it. And what worked for me a lot, and it was always interesting for me, the process of kind of writing a script for an episode of the podcast, was that I write a lot. I write a lot about my character, and, you know, even if I'm just kind of compiling a list of the things that I had done over the last 2 hours of gameplay. And not just like making a list of the things that I did, but being more prosaic about it. Yeah, no, what always helped me a lot was writing about it. And you know, sometimes I wouldn't have time, but it was always good for me to not only reflect on let's say 2 hours of gameplay, to reflect on what I'd done and what that meant to my character. But then it makes the kind of decisions that I make for the next 2 hours of gameplay a little bit more natural. And so that was always kind of my practice. You know, I'm sure that doesn't work for everybody. I, on one hand, you know, I really enjoy writing. I don't know if I'm any good at it, but,
you like it, who cares?
Well, you were mentioning that you figured that you probably wouldn't publish anything anytime,
right?
Like
not,
that,
it's
but
not for anybody's purpose, but my own, but it, that's, you know, I mean, nobody role plays for anybody else's benefit.
Well, good point.
So be interesting to see it though. It's about
it
thought
would.
Process, right?
Yeah. And you know, there are, if you look, there are people that kind of blog about what their character has been doing. And I've looked at those. I never really had much interest in doing one myself, but everybody, you know, like you said, everybody kind of role plays their own way. So so my approach, my strategy was always to kind of to write a lot about it. I always found that worked really, really well for me, because I read a lot too. And with other things, like, you know, I'm always reading different fantasy. I don't read really anything else other than fantasy, but there's not that much, except for, you know, if you get the Kindle version of all these in-game books, there's not that much Elder Scrolls stuff that you could be reading. So, you know, like I've enjoyed recently playing through The Witcher 3 and being able to read The Witcher books at the same time. And that's always kind of allows for me to kind of immerse myself a little bit more, but that's not necessarily a possibility when you're playing Skyrim or Morrowind, unless you are going to read those in-game books. But yeah, for me, it was always kind of like writing, not while I'm playing, but kind of just writing about it. And so it was interesting for me. Yeah. It was interesting for me to kind of write the scripts for the podcast, because it's still writing about it, but taking a little bit of a different approach. And later in the later seasons, I started to try something new, where instead of having kind of an academic episode about, you know, the Psijic monks or, you know, whatever it is, starting to expand on events that we know happened in the history of Tamriel, but we don't know anything about. So I was kind of like, I don't know, somewhere in between, like, you know, message board fan fiction and, you know, going to the Imperial Library or something for something concrete. And then all of that kind of being filtered through the voice of this kind of unnamed traveling character. So that, for me, came a little bit more naturally because I've been doing that for years. So I've been kind of talking about, writing about what my characters have been doing and so on and so forth.
Yeah. Now, you have a mod, right? There's a mod with some of the books or writings that is available, right? Is that still
yes.
available?
Yeah, it's on the workshop. Okay. So as those, and that was that was exciting. That was an exciting thing to be a part of. I'm not really I don't have too much mod experience. I've worked in 3D environments before and working with game engines and so on and so forth. And the creation kit, as you may well know, is actually really easy to use. So when the idea came to me to make a mod, it was something that was like, oh, that would be awesome if I could do that. And then kind of being like, well, I can do that.
and not a lot of people probably working on this have got a master's in digital media. So.
Yeah. So, and the scope for me, and it was the same way with the podcast kind of blew up in my face, but the scope was always meant to be small, and so it stayed pretty small. And like, as an episode was released in this new format where there would be this mysterious kind of elderly traveler traveling through Skyrim and elsewhere and telling these stories, there would be a corresponding written version that would be added in game.
Did you actually make the mod yourself, or did you work with someone else, or how'd you do that?
No, I did. Okay. And again, the scope of the mod was very small, so it wasn't really unmanageable for me. The gist of it was really every time one of these episodes would be released, you know, this kind of story told by this wandering traveler, a written version of it would be made available in game.
Okay.
Every time I would update it with one of these new books, I would also change the location of the I added a character that was actually this kind of mysterious traveler, and I added him to the game. I never really had the time to figure out how to make him travel.
Okay.
So I just kind of like changed his location every time I updated him.
Cool,
on.
That's all right.
It's just fast travel.
Because but people did kind of look around for him and get kind of excited cool. when they found him.
Wanderer sightings?
Yeah, there were definitely wanderer sightings. I was thinking for a little while of doing like a poster screenshot, but that never came to fruition. But then it grew a little bit. And what I started to do was, I started to write a compendium, if you will, of everything that I had learned throughout the entire process of making the podcast. And so the idea for me was just to you know, again, it was small in scope in the beginning, and then kept growing. You know, it started off, there were chapters about the coming of men, there was chapters about the Nords and so on and so forth, basic beliefs. And so then I figured, well, why don't I add those in the mod too? And so I created another character who kind of sits in the basement of the Bard's College in solitude and just sells these books that were just kind of abbreviated versions of these much more in-depth kind of essays that I had written about these times or people throughout Tamrielic history. And that's a project that I'm still kind of working on. It's 30 or 40 pages at this point.
Cool. That sounds like, and the I don't next really mod know, to me.
Yeah, I don't know what my end game for that is, but it was really fun doing that. But I think like right around the time I was doing it, Falskar came out. And so I was like, oh man. But you know, he's that guy's like working for Bungie now, so maybe I don't feel so bad.
Well, it depends on how much you want to work for Bungie.
Yeah, true.
That is really cool. I mean, you know, you I think you created so much great content there that it would almost be a shame not to put it into the game. It's like,
right.
It's wonderful, a lot of that stuff. And I know that, you know, on my Let's Play, for example, I wrote a lot of stuff down too, and I started sticking it into books and putting them in game just for my own enjoyment. You know, and so, you know, if I felt like I had a character who needed to live by a certain set of maxims, I would write those down and put them in a book, and the character would have the book in his inventory all the time, you know? And it was that, you know, I like the simplicity of, you know, the creation kit and being able to, I mean, once you understand its quirks, being right. able to, you know, put in there pretty much anything I need to, you know, to support the story I'm trying to tell, you know, in my own head. So,
absolutely.
Cool. Yeah. Well, I mean, one of the questions I wanted to ask you, and this is one that we have debates about all the time, is this phrase I hate, it's lore friendly.
oh, good, because he uses it right in some of the materials. It's lore friendly. Nice job, Stu.
What does that even mean? I think it just means different people, different things to different people. Like it's treated like sort of like, you know, this stamp of approval, like you would get, you know, from the Better Business Bureau. This mod is lore friendly, and yet it's based on a completely subjective thing, in my view. What are your thoughts on that?
So for me, and this might be cheating, but for me, you know, one of the beautiful and also kind of underhanded results of knowing about the existence of something like a metaphysical aspect at like Kim, where a person can effectively, you know, ascend to some realm of existence where they can make or unmake anything at will, really kind of levels the playing field for almost anything. And there's some more esoteric aspects of the lore that I think is brilliant, and that I incorporate into my own kind of headcanon. And there's parts of it that are like a little too out there for me. But I've always been very, very strict about the mods that I let in. Mm-hmm. And that's extended into the podcast too, because I do talk about some things that's not, you know, we'll say sanctioned Bethesda lore, but you know, for me, the original plan for the podcast was to really help people immerse themselves and feel like they were part of something greater. So if I spend too much time talking about stuff that's not available in game, or it's not part of the game architecture, then, you know, I might be giving them an experience that maybe in some ways goes against the spirit of the original game. I think the fact that there's mod support is huge. Don't get me wrong. But some people go out there and they'll download the Macho Man Randy Savage Dragon mod and they'll love it. But I haven't seen that yet. traditionally I've always been really close-minded about the mods that I allow in. That being said, and I do believe they are advertised as being lore friendly. But anything 13 Oranges has done really is incredible to me. You can look them up on the Skyrim Workshop. And they're not huge mods. They're places here and places there. Sometimes they're taken out of, I think there's a few places, locations that they've added into Skyrim that don't appear in Skyrim, but they appeared in, Arena. The architecture is all very believable, and there's nothing about it that's like, Macho Man Randy Savage.
Do you have any other podcasts about the 13 Oranges mods or anything?
No, I've never actually talked about mods on the podcast.
Well, a lot of people haven't. I'm getting into Skyrim now, early. I'm the noob guy who's got no mods installed and keeps forgetting how to, put on armor and stuff. but to not go through mod review, but something where you found it to be an important part of your storytelling is always interesting for me, because I'm trying to build this list of how do I build this perfect Skyrim world mashup with everybody's favorite things, right?
Yeah. If I'm completely honest, like the mods that I usually use are really just kind of quality of life mods. There's like a better horses mod that make your horses a little bit smarter in combat. There's player housing. That's really it. And I'm pretty selective about, which player housing I use too, because I want something I'm not looking for the 14 room mansion at the top of the throat of the world with a swimming pool in the basement for some reason. Usually what it amounts to for me is like, I want like a hunting cabin in the woods where I can like bring my pelts at the end of the day. And that's tough. It's hard to find those.
Yeah.
It's much easier to find the 13 room mansion, at the top of the throat of the world.
Yeah. Some of the extravagant ones.
And it's important to look outside of the Steam Workshop too, because, the Skyrim Nexus or the Elder Scrolls Nexus, is a great resource, for anything that, if anything uses, the Skyrim, script extender or anything like that, like those things aren't going to appear on the workshop.
Right.
Or they will, but you won't even be able to download them.
Right.
I don't really know if that answers your question or if there was a question to begin with, but I would do what you want to do. I wouldn't do what I want to do.
Yeah. I completely agree. I mean, the beauty of the thing is that you can kind of make the game whatever you want it to be. I'm fairly selective about the mods that I use as well, but if a person wants to make it an anime wonderland, they can make it an anime wonderland. That's just how it is. And that's what I love about it. That's why I find it interesting when you watch Let's Plays, for example, watch different people and what they choose to install and how they choose to play it. It's like everybody's game has their own thumbprint on it,
Right.
And you get a sense for who they are and what they like. And I've seen some that are kind of really fantastical, where they're just using some really wild ENBs and flora and fauna overhauls and riding on unicorns. And it's just insane, but it's really interesting. And I'm like, that's not for me, but that's all you. And that's cool. Very cool. Yeah.
Yeah. That's something that's always kind of in the forefront of my mind. Obviously when you're playing a game like Morrowind or Oblivion or Skyrim, especially if you're going to role play a character, like you need to know how to use the console commands. I don't know, maybe you don't need to, but it helps. Especially when you're building a character, like in kind of that first time that you're going to play.
Mm-hmm. Like if you need a whole bunch of gold.
Yeah. Yes. I've heard you can do that.
Yes.
I've decided to be rich from the start.
Yeah. So, so you know what? You might be into that 13 room. You might be into that 13 room mansion at the top of the throne of the world.
Yeah.
But the argument for me is always interesting when, you know, like when you're looking through the Steam discussions or something and somebody's looking for cheats and they're like, oh, why would you cheat? Like, why would you cheat? Why would you do that? And to some extent, like, okay, maybe you might make the argument that that's not how the game is meant to be played. But who cares how the game is meant to be played? If this is the way that this person wants to play it, then...
Like, I think, Stuart, your method to building the your outpost lends to that.
Yeah, absolutely. I had recently released a video on YouTube on Tundra Defense, which, you know, it's a mod that's primarily designed for you to create a small fortress in Skyrim any place you want to and then play sort of horde mode, you know, where you have people attack your fortress, right?
Right.
But what's wonderful about the mod is even if you're not going to do that, it has all these great tools which essentially let you build your own little, you know, fort anywhere you want in the entire place, right?
Right.
Which is immensely powerful and very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And for the character I was playing at the time, I mean, when you if you really want to build something nice, it costs a lot of money in game.
Yeah.
So, you know, given that my character was an Imperial soldier, I said, okay, for every, you know, 2,000 gold I make, I'm going to have the Imperial government match. So, you know, then I had a pool of 4,000 septims.
Nice.
Hey, I can build a lot more walls and fortifications for 4,000 septims.
That is a handy storyline.
Oh, yeah.
Where does the Empire get all this money from?
I don't know. I think that they steal it. They take it from other provinces and they give it to me.
They give it to you.
Yeah, they give it
to build your fort.
To build my fort in Skyrim because of the bandit problem and the storm cloaks. It's just
they're paying you off to solve the bandit problem. Whatever, 2,000 septims,
maybe
just do
the
it.
Thalmor give it to them and they give it to me.
I don't know.
Well, who do you answer to then? That's the question.
Yeah, well, you know, in my story I answered to really nobody but RK, perhaps.
I'll never forget. And this is maybe kind of indicative, but my first Elder Scrolls experience was when I went over to a friend's house, and he had Morrowind on his computer, and he was like, "Oh, you should check this out. I feel like you'd be into it." And I think that he was playing the main quest, but he just like let me sit down with his character, and he was in the middle of the Ashlands. And so I'm like, I sit down and I'm looking around and there's a huge sandstorm and I'm like, I don't really know what I should be doing. And so I kind of wander around, you know, the wilderness for a while and he leaves and he's going to, you know, do whatever he leaves. He walks out of the room for a minute. But, you know, I eventually stumbled across one of the Ashlander camps and all of a sudden there's other people there and they're kind of like holding their arms up in front of their faces against the sandstorm. And for me, all of these moments from Morrowind, they're burned in my brain. And there's these people that are like interacting with the weather around them, right? They're like holding their arms up so the dust doesn't get in their eyes. So I kind of walk around the camp for a bit and I go into one of the yurts. You know, and there's this like beautiful deep orange glow coming from one of those lanterns. And, you know, there's a dude in there. So I talk to the dude for a few minutes. Anyway, yeah. So I walk into the yurt and there's, you know, you guys know what I'm talking about, right? The Ashlander camps.
Yep.
There's all these beautiful, like deep maroon colored lanterns with all this like strange script on them. And I talk to the guy for a while and I leave. And when I leave, the sandstorm has ended. And so all you can hear is the wind and those like the beautiful sound of those wooden chimes that hang from the top of the tents. And it was just, it like blew me away. Up until this point, I had been like, I was raised on a steady diet of like Quake 2 and like Tony Hawk Pro Skater.
Right.
So for me, this was a real formative experience. That when I like entered my entire self into this video game, and you know, he comes back and I haven't done anything. I've like stayed there in the camp, like walking around and talking to everybody. And he's like, "What are you doing, dude? You should go and like, you know, kill the monsters." And I kind of looked at him and I was like, "I'm good. I'm enjoying myself. You know,
yeah.
Like, it doesn't matter. I don't want to kill anything right now. I'm just gonna talk to these nice people and listen to these wooden chimes."
Wow.
And
that's kind of awesome.
Give me the controller back.
Exactly.
Very cool.
Yeah, but you know, he was also one of those kids where you know, you play like Mortal Kombat with them, and they like don't give you an opportunity to stand up.
Yeah,
you know, it kind of like knocks you down. And
I have some other people who play that way. I don't play Mortal Kombat anyway.
Yeah,
anymore.
Well, this is one of those games where you really can, if you just kind of give yourself over to it, it does some amazing things. And I think one of my favorite things to do now, and we've talked about it a few times, but is just really go into the game with the bones of a character and just spend the first 10 levels allowing the game to kind of steer you around and see what starts coming to mind for ideas about what you want to do. And there are a lot of times when I sort of, you know, I think of the first 5 to 10 levels as almost like, you know, these are just my experimentation throwaway levels, and I'm going to actually start playing this character at level 11 when I've had a chance to really kind of absorb everything and decide what I want to do. Because you'll find that the game presents you with moments like that that just blow you away. I mean, when I first got Skyrim, I just remember at some point stopping and just dropping my controller, and I stood up and clapped my hands like, "Oh my God, this is awesome," you know? And I realized at that moment that this was a game that I could just while away many, many hours on. And that's before I even realized that creation kit was an option and that mods were an option and all that stuff. So it certainly has a ton to offer if you're willing to invest the time and really, you know, really kind of commit to the story.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Know? So, well, you know, I know that there's probably a ton more that we could talk to you about. It's been super fun to talk to you, kind of get your perspective on things. I know that we've all been kind of immersed in your podcast. So,
it's been great having you on.
Thanks for having me. Of course.
Yeah, yeah. So, if people want to find your work, where do they find it, Cory?
Well, they can go to elderlore.wordpress.com. The podcast is and always will be available on iTunes, so or on the blog, so they can get it either one of those places.
Okay. You got any new projects that you're working on that you want to promote?
Well, like I said earlier, I'm still really kind of working a lot on this kind of written compendium of everything. So people should keep an eye out for that. When it's finished, you know, I now that you mentioned it, you know, it seems like a good idea to release that in game. But I'll also release it just kind of to the public. So that could prove to be, a handy resource for people to have too.
For sure.
That's great. Thanks so much for joining us, Cory. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
All right. Hopefully we'll talk to you again, soon.
Yeah.
We'll get some updates.
Definitely need to keep in touch. And I was super excited to get your perspective on all sorts of things. Yeah, it's been a lot of fun just listening.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks, you know where to find me.
All right. Thank you and good Perfect. Night.
All right.
Have a good
Bye,
night.
Bye, Cory.
Bye.
It is time for Crusader Mail. I'm pretty excited about this, especially when we talk about the topic of immersion and lore and all that stuff. So what do we got that's kind of related this week?
All right. Well, we have submission by Obi from Illinois, and they are playing on the PC and are running mods.
Okay.
And their question is, I have a Breton character that I'm trying to make into a battle mage. That will eventually become a war hero. However, I'm having trouble as to what factions he should join. Any tips or ideas on what road to travel down?
Okay, so by faction, are we assuming in the Civil War?
That was my take, but...
Mm-hmm. I suppose there could be other things. But he specifically is talking about... I think he's talking about...
It sounds like taking sides kind of thing.
Okay.
Unless you want to somehow get into the the Briarhearts and
Well,
I don't think you can join that faction.
Well,
yes and no.
Yes and no. Yeah,
they still attack you, but
yeah, and it is possible to when you go through. There's a Sidna Mine quest line where if you follow that through, you have an option to kind of sort of join with them, but they're still hostile to you. They're just not hostile to you in certain areas.
Yeah. So I would be willing to bet that he's talking about the Civil War, Stormcloak versus Imperial. That's or she. I guess it's Obi isn't really specifically male or female, so I apologize.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I guess if we're approaching this just purely from sort of a racial standpoint, I don't know that one option is necessarily stronger than the next. There's definitely, I would think, some impact by proximity. Because we do know that High Rock is actually adjacent to Skyrim. It sort of implies that there's cross-border trade between the two nations and so forth, that there would be a relationship there. So on the one hand, I could definitely see someone, you know, if they were a Breton who was accustomed to being exposed to the Nords of Skyrim frequently, might side with them.
Right.
Maybe thinking, oh, you know, this is the buffer between us and the Thalmor or the Imperials. And, or maybe it's completely a mercenary thing. We're going to go down there and we're going to fight in Skyrim just because we don't want the war on our doorstep, for example.
Right.
So I could definitely see a Breton character perhaps
going Stormcloak.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure. If you're just using something like proximity and maybe some of these ideas around politics and trade as a basis, perhaps.
Sure.
But I definitely think that it might require digging a little bit deeper into the lore and the history of
The two nations.
Well, yeah. What do the Bretons have in terms of history where the Thalmor are concerned, or
feelings of
the Imperials? You know, so
you know. And for me, I guess Battle Mage always sounded more Imperial. It sounded more refined to me than what I would expect on a Stormcloak side. But that's just perception.
Yeah, definitely. I think I think that there's always there's potential for, as we've seen, many different kinds, you know, many different flavors of Battle Mage. You know, in your example, right, you started out talking about a Battle Mage that was very sort of focused on this tribal idea, right? But we can definitely see that, you know, we would have Battle Mages, for example, who were part of, you know, probably very polished units that worked for larger armies and, you know, things like that.
Right.
So I guess you could take it any direction you wanted to. I think it just depends on what sort of character you want to play. Do you want to say that this is a Breton who is defending his homeland, or is this a Breton who is, you know, an expatriate and is in Cyrodiil and has become a member of the Imperial Army and is now...
Well, yeah, and maybe, you know, maybe, you know, keep your eye out in-game to see if there's any things that happened during the playthrough that might... sway their allegiance one way or the other.
Yeah.
I think the history and the lore between the two nations, the High Rock and Skyrim and Imperials and Cyrodiil, and I think that's a good thing to keep in mind to get a underlying base opinion. But the character itself, I mean, they could maybe start off on that generalization, but if there's something in game that happens that could very well steer them the opposite direction unexpectedly.
Right. The cool thing about this, obviously, is there's no wrong answer. But one of the things that I think is a particularly interesting point, which I've been digging into right now as I try to set the stage for the Dark Messenger, playthrough, is this idea of men versus myrrh, right? It's a divide that is it's not just a racial divide. It's steeped in a very different way of thinking about the whole idea of divinity and worship.
Right.
And there is this whole sort of theory out there about the races of man versus the elves, right?
Right.
Where, you know, when Lorcan creates the world and then he's torn asunder, you know, he's torn apart by the other gods in retaliation for doing this, right? And men, there are a lot of sort of, I think, parts of the lore that sort of depict, in particular, Nords, but men in general, as feeling as though they owe some sort of, you know, great fealty to Lorcan or Shore, for the fact that he has become the creator and the defender of men, whereas the Myr resent it because they feel like the creation of Mundus separated them from their divine selves.
Right.
Which is really interesting. The elves view themselves as having been gods and been brought low, whereas the men view themselves as having been created, right?
Right. One's been divided and the other's been created.
Right. So I think if you look at something like that, you could even say, you could take a deeper approach and say, this is about the races of men, the Bretons and the Redguards and the Nords. You know, they're the races of men who have been, you know, brutally subjugated by the elves throughout history. You know, I think the progenitors of the Imperials were the Natick tribes who were horribly treated by the Khymer elves, you know, and stuff like that.
Oh, for sure.
So there's this, you could play it that way too, and this kind of gets into some of the things we've talked about before, where can we create a larger conflict? What's a larger scope that we can fit everything into? And part of what I'm trying to do now, which could help here too, is to just think about that larger context where maybe we have a scenario where we just kind of play up this ideological divide, this cultural divide between men and Myr, you know, and say that maybe I'm the battle mage and my objective is to ultimately, I'm not concerned about Skyrim and factions in Skyrim so much as I am about not ceding any more territory to a single elf, no matter what.
Which would put you smack on the Stormcloak side.
It would. Or in a situation where maybe you're working the Imperial side thinking you're going to turn something from the inside, or you're going to be a double agent, or you're, you know, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So obviously the sky's the limit, but it all depends on, you know, your own headcanon.
Headcanon, I like that. Yeah.
Yes, that Corey, we will be using the term headcanon, and that will be on t-shirt number 3. I don't know. Any other ideas, guys? That's what comes immediately to mind to me, but...
Yeah, I think that's a lot to chew on right there.
Yeah, it is.
So you've got, you know, racial conflict or ideological conflict.
Religious conflict.
But they're all at a level that you could play through and feel...
And make sense of, yes.
Yeah, exactly.
For sure. Mm-hmm. And I kind of like the idea of maybe going into the Imperial side thinking that you're going to be, you know, this, you know, mole, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And then you could play that either out as you succeed and then get back into the Stormcloak, whether that's through console command or in-game, however you want to try to do that.
Yep.
Or... maybe you get sucked in and start believing what the Imperials have to say.
Yeah. And then you end up with all
kinds
of...
You end up being a traitor.
Well, yeah.
In some respects.
Absolutely.
So there's a lot of different ways to go about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would think... I think the message here is think about the larger context and what sort of larger message you want your adventure to have, and then kind of fit into that. There's any number of different ways that you can justify choosing one side or the other. And just come up with your story then, right?
Yeah.
So
I think so.
I don't know. In my history, I've played both sides and liked both quests equally well. They were super fun,
for
either
reasons.
One. So, there's no wrong choice.
Perfect.
But tell us what your choice was.
Yeah, we'd love to know. We'd love to know how you resolved it, what you did.
Yeah, where'd you end up?
Exactly.
Cool.
One more.
One more from Caladran in Finland.
Hello, Caladran.
And Caladran writes, hello, guys. I try to explain my dilemma clearly. I have an Assassin Dunmer roleplay going and feel I can't put more story to move it on. Kind of stuck. How can I make more story or throw obstacles to him? I don't want to quit the story yet. My other concern is that it might be similar as any other assassin story. Mm-hmm. How to make it different?
Okay.
And then all I'll add is, thanks for the podcast. Keep it going. And that's it.
So, Caladran, we really don't know what she's completed to this point, though, do we?
No. It sounds like, obviously going an assassin route, but doesn't want to take a typical assassin playthrough.
Yeah.
Dunmer, personally, I'm a big Dunmer Bobo, so I like the Dunmers.
Right. Well, I mean, maybe to start with, we should think about the stereotypical stuff that a person could do.
Sure.
You know, I mean, obviously, the dark and brooding assassin, the loner, da 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 da, all that crap has been done. So what could you do to take this in another direction? I think the other thing that has been done a lot is the whole redemption thing, right? Like, I was this terrible assassin and now I'm going to be the mighty hero and I'm going to just make up for all the crap I ever did.
You sound really sold on that one.
Right. Well, here's the thing. I mean, I don't want to give Caladran a bum steer. I think the objective here is I think she's stuck because she knows what all those stereotypes are. She doesn't want to do that.
Exactly.
So what could we do? I mean, Dunmer, they're elves.
Yep.
You know, there are some things we know, about their culture and stuff like that. But I don't think we need to rely on that necessarily to come up with a concept here.
Take the Dexter route.
The Dexter route?
The Dexter route.
Oh.
So she enjoys the kill. It's almost kind of a sickness.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a matter of finding the right client so that she feels she's killing them
right.
as a service and trying to, make use of her sickness or
that,
something.
That
like
is an
that.
Interesting twist. So that what I like about that is it's kind of a demented view of the redemption story in a way, where what we're saying is she's turning her attention to what she has decided in her mind are the right targets because of some belief system that she has that, for whatever reason, certain types of individuals deserve to be targeted. Whatever that rationale it is, whatever that psychology or that, code is that she lives by that makes her decide who her victims are is part of it. But the other part is that I know, like in Dexter, right? He thinks of himself as kind of an avenging angel, and his killing is okay because the people that he's killing deserve it.
Yeah.
But it eventually drags him deeper into deeper, darker places, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And it gets worse.
It gets worse. It was something that, like, his father knew, growing up that this kid had issues.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I think, for an assassin, it's interesting from this character's perspective because on one hand, she knows she's a monster. On the other hand, she accepts it and is trying to channel that into, maybe it is simply just money, or maybe she thinks she's serving some greater good in doing it. But she knows what she is and she struggles with it and I think that could provide some interesting context to whatever quest comes up.
Yep, I think that's a great idea, and I think you could further amp up the role play opportunities by obviously you're going to have to come up with some psychology or story for yourself that allows you to understand what the characteristics are of a person who is the right target. But in the same way, I think there should also be some kind of a struggle associated with that. Like, I like the idea that this person isn't just a mechanical killer who's in it for the money. I like the idea that there's a compulsion involved in it somehow, because what that does is it allows you to create a scenario where they're going to be in situations where their impulse is going to be to kill, but they're going to have to not kill, right? Like, you know, create a scenario not only where it's like, oh, you know, I'm doing the greater, the everybody some good here by killing this person who's obviously bad, but also try to create an inverse scenario where, you know, there are individuals who maybe, you know, everybody else might feel like definitely need killing. Right.
Well, I'm kind of wondering if you can play even a different part of that and have each of those targets be they're being released from something rather than targeted for some other thing. You know, it's not because they're bad or because they're inherently evil, but, you know, it's my time to release this person. Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know, I wonder, in hearing you talk, another idea came to mind of, you know, I'm trying to think of assassin stories that you haven't heard of too often or stereotypical. Yeah, I was thinking maybe this character is at either the beginning of joining or becoming an assassin, right? If she or he has a sickness, how do I channel this? And it's that journey. Or perhaps it's at the end. And what you're really looking for is a way out of life. And so you're trying to find that target, that challenge that's going to end you.
Yeah.
And you're, you know, so good at what you do, it's difficult to find that. But you're hoping that, you know, you don't want to go out peacefully. You want to go out in your job, if you will.
A constant
suicide
search.
By cop, almost.
Yeah, but a constant search for that person who is better than you.
Right.
You know, it's really hard to find someone who's better than you if you are the best at what you do.
Right. Right.
You know, and you have to test that against everybody.
Yeah, maybe this is a person whose ego and their mania is kind of like, you know, all tied together in this whole thing, right? Where they are sort of a quintessential loner, but it's not necessarily because they shun society or they want to be alone. It's because they despise everyone around them. Yeah. There's no one here who's worthy of me, and I'm going to try to find the one who is. The one who is the only person who's worthy of being with me is the person who's capable of killing me.
Yeah.
Right? That kind of twisted psychology.
That's an interesting approach. I'm not a loner, but I despise all of you.
Yeah, I know. Well. You know,
Sherlock and Moriarty kind of.
There's the loner.
But there has to be the mirror image, right?
The loner who isolates because they don't want to be around people, and then there's the person who's the megalomaniac or the egomaniac, the person who doesn't associate with people because they're beneath them, right? Right.
You're looking for your equal, or better,
and thrives only because they're amongst them,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
yeah.
I'm talking with my hands. Like,
well, what I would say for Caladran, it's obvious this character's had some progression already, and she's looking for a way to revive the character and renew her interest in it. And what I would suggest is looking for a track like we're talking about here, but then having some kind of in-game, having some kind of formative moment, like something where a moment where everything changes, right? Where they make this switch, and I would use mods to change the way they look, change a hairstyle, change the way they dress, change the way they do things. You get the sense that something has happened that's transformed them into sort of a new way of viewing the world and a new mission. Doing that helps you get in the brain space a little bit.
Two words.
For what are you trying to do?
Assless chaps.
Again.
And that will change everything.
It's kind of a theme going on here, Dave.
I know, right?
and it comes full circle now.
It does. It really does.
Well, either the chaps or maybe the jean shorts.
Right. Shorts are the way to go.
Assless jean shorts.
Now you're getting way too 1990s for
all
of us.
Oh, gosh. All right. Well, I mean, I hope that helps, Caladran. Obviously, we're just kind of tossing out some ideas, not really knowing the details of where you are in terms of level and what quests you finished already. But if you have any follow-up questions, obviously, send them along.
Or let us know the direction that you took.
Yeah, yeah. Let us know what you end up doing. We'd love to get some updates. Well, dear listener, we've come to the end of another episode. We'd like to thank fans of the show for your faithful support and continued encouragement. Your enthusiasm is a lifeblood of this podcast, and whether your support comes through Patreon with dollars or through iTunes with reviews or recommendations to your friends and family, we appreciate it all. You can contact us through our website at charactercrusade.com. And until next time, remember, it's not about the objective, it's about the journey. So go forth and experience.
You have one old message.
Character Crusade is a proud member of the N4G TV and Maker Studios Partner Network. N4G TV partners have access to exclusive production assets that are second to none and maintain full creative control over their channels. That's you. And that's me, and that's these Crusaders. Partner benefits include 24/7 customer support, SEO, a dedicated graphics team, I love me some graphics, a catalog of more than 400,000 licensed music and sound effects, and more. Learn more. Learn more at n4gtv.com, and tell them Jimmy sent you.
End of messages.
It.
Let's do this.
Let's wing some shit, shall we? Let's wing it.
Wing-a-ling-a-ding-dong.
All right, Jimmy, let's just wing this thing.
Let's wing it, gentlemen.
Let's write a song about it. Unless you want to start talking about dragons and sea captains.
Dragons.
That's right, Vasily. One ping only.
I love that.
Don't anger the bear. I found that it's a good idea.
Don't anger the bear.
Well, yes. After you're talking about the giant bear in Helgen, I'm like, what the hell are you talking about? How did I not see it?
They used to say that during the Cold War.
Don't anger the bear.
Yeah. Greetings, Crusaders. You're listening to Character Crusade, Skyrim Roleplay Workshop. I'm Stu.
And I'm Joe.
And I'm still Matt.
still Matt, and we are still Character Crusade.
We are.
Thank you for joining us. This is episode 9, and we are going to be talking about lore, and we're going to be talking about immersion. We've got an interview later on with Cory Merchant from Elder Lore Podcast, and we're going to be talking...
It's actually what? Episode 10.
Is it? Son of a bitch. Hey, thanks for coming in. We wanted to have you do a sponsor read for us. Would you mind doing that?
That'd be fine. Hang on for a minute here.
Yeah, you got to talk in the other end.
This end?
No, the other end.
That right there. Is that better?
Yeah, we can hear you real good.
This is weird.
Joe, do you have the copy?
Oh, yeah.
Here. Just read that first paragraph. That's kind of it's a thank you message, right?
I talk in right here.
Yeah, talk into the microphone.
All right. We're supported by you, the fans of Couch Warrior TV and Character Crusade. Whether contributing to our Patreon campaign or simply helping us spread the word, none of this would be possible without your support. Go to patron.charactercrusade.com to learn about the benefits of supporting the Crusade with a recurring donation and help keep the Crusade rolling.
Wow, that was great.
Is that all because, like, I'm double parked outside?
Yeah. Go.
The guys have been keeping the engine running.
Well, I thank you for coming in and taking the time. We really appreciate it. I mean...
My pleasure. I'm going to stop by whenever I want to.
Okay, well, you know, it's good to have a super fan in the neighborhood, so... Feel free.
Not always in the neighborhood. But thank you, Character Crusade,
yes.
Guys.
Hey, you know, don't let us keep you any longer.
I'm out of here.
Thank you for coming in.
Thank you. Yeah. Bye.
Bye-bye.